Hi all, welcome to Smart Catalyst. Today we are going to see the news analysis dated 29th November 2018. So these are the five topics which we are going to see for the prelims. The first one is related to the report on heat waves. Second one is that the fragile climate puts food security at risk. Third one is the new method of calculation of the GDP which has been changed in 2015 and its effect on economy. And fourth one is the place in news, that is the Gabon in Africa. Fifth one is the protecting the indigenous people of Andaman and Nicobar. So now we shall see the first article, Lancet report on the heat waves. So this article has been taken from the Hindu. And this is also pertained to the disaster management. Which is under Mains also. So here the heat wave has been tagged as a silent disaster. So we shall see what is the heat wave. Heat wave is an abnormally high temperatures more than the normal maximum temperature. So apart from the high temperature, abnormally high temperatures will be regarded as the heat waves. So this will be occurring in the summer season, especially in the northwestern parts of India. This heat waves has some health impacts, which are as follows: dehydration, which is common in summer seasons, especially in the northern region, and apart from this, it is the heat cramps, and the third one is the main thing is the heat stroke. So now we shall see the findings of the report. The report says that from 2014 to 17, the average length of the heat waves is ranged from 3 to 4 days. When compared with the average global rate, it is just 0.8 to 1.8 days globally, but in India it is 3 to 4 days. So here we can compare the difference, how the heat wave is going to be a silent disaster. Indians were exposed to almost 60 million heat waves comparatively to the 40 million heat waves in 2012. So as I have already said that these heat waves have numerous health impacts, which is going to affect the potential of the human capital. Now the general impacts of the heat waves in other dimensions are the increased rates of heat stress and heat stroke can lead to heart failure, and because of which it may lead to other multiple organ failure also, like kidney injuries because of the dehydration caused due to this heat stress. So apart from the health impacts, it is going to affect the labor hours, especially those who are working in the primary sector, that is the agricultural fields. A statistic says that about 153 billion of labor hours would be lost in 2017 due to the heat, which is an increase of 62 billion hours from the year 2000. So this is going to affect the human capital and thereby causing the Indian economy under great distress. Also, a recent World Bank report on South Asia's hotspots have predicted that 2.8% of erosion of the country's GDP by 2050 because of this loss of labor hours due to the heat stress. And India is going to be the first victim among the countries globally who will experience high social and economic costs from the climate change. So proper steps has to be taken by the government to arrest this silent disaster of heat waves. So now we are going to see the second article, which is the climate change that puts food security at great risk. And this article has been taken from the paper Hindu. As we all know, the ambitious sustainable development goals, which has been time framed between 2015 and 2030. As we all know, the ambitious sustainable development goals that has been framed between 2015 to 2030, it has a goal number 2 of ending hunger and achieving food security through sustainable agriculture. So the climate change is going to be a major threat to attain this status of sustainable development goal. And the UN Food and Agricultural Organization in its recent report revealed that feeding a hungry planet is growing increasingly difficult. So this is the major reason for this is that increasing climate change and depletion of land, that is improper usage of land without any sustainable methods. So we shall see what are the major findings of this report. On one hand, the population is growing rapidly, so the demand for food is increasing. The demand should be met with more nutritious food at affordable prices. However, on the other hand, the Earth's carrying capacity in terms of land, water, and climate change has been utilized unsustainably. So this becomes a challenge to meet the food demands of the growing population. And the second reason, as the report states, that is that ongoing civil strifes and other conflicts worldwide because of the power struggle. And the main example is that the Yemen crisis, which is a threat to food security. Also, in Afghanistan, due to severe drought and conflict, it had led to displacement of more than 2.5 lakh people, according to the UNHCR. So, the way forward is to adopt better policies and technologies to reach the zero hunger of sustainable development goal 2. Apart from this, it is imperative to have a sustainable expansion of land and land use patterns. And also, it should be noted that if the farm output is going beyond the sustainable levels, it is going to cause a permanent damage to the ecosystems, which is irreversible. Now, the third article is the new data for growth phase of the economy. So, this article has been taken from the paper Mint. In 2015, the government of India has introduced two important changes in the method of GDP calculation. The first one is that change of base year from 2004-5 to 2011-12. And the second change is that a new method to measure the output. For this, they have used the GVA at market prices from the traditional method of GDP at factor cost. So now we shall see what is this gross value addition method. So for this, let's assume a scenario in the manufacturing sector. So there is wheat. So this is converted to bread and this is converted to sandwich. The cost of production for this wheat is rupees 10. For making this bread, it took rupees 40, and for this sandwich, it took rupees 100. So this is an assumption. So here, the value addition from one product to this product happens to be rupees 30, right? So from the bread to sandwich, it took rupees 60. So here, the GVA has to be calculated as GVA is equal to this cost of factor of production for wheat, that is 10, plus the value addition has been done to this wheat, that is rupees 30, and then the bread that has been converted to sandwich for rupees 60. Finally, the GVA is nothing but rupees 100. So here the sum is 100. So this 100 is being taken for the new method of calculation of GDP. But the old method is considering only about the GDP at the factor cost, that is the factors of production for this sandwich, which includes other areas also. So this GVA should be taken for the market price, so which includes the indirect taxes and reducing the subsidies. So this is the new method that has been adopted for the calculation of the GDP. Now we shall see what's there in news. The GDP back series data released by the Niti Aayog states that India's GDP growth have never crossed over 9% in the last decade, which means the UPA government projection of GDP growth at more than 9% is just a false factor that has been calculated with the traditional method of GDP at factor cost using the base year of 2004-5. So, why this new method of GDP calculation has been adopted is to get a better assessment of the growth trend using this GVA at market prices, and allows the better comparison and forecast, and also to adjust for the better methodology and data. Apart from these tweaks of the NDA government in 2015, they have also changed the source of information through which the GDP has been calculated. That is, the old method uses the annual survey of industries report for the calculation of the GDP. But the new 2015 GDP calculation method has shifted to the reports from the Corporate Affairs Ministries of 21. So this should be noted for the prelims perspective, as such type of questions have been already asked. Also, the move towards this method of GDP calculation has brought the method in par with other international agencies like IMF and World Bank. So this would be helpful to compare the India's total outputs with other emerging economies' outputs. So now we shall see the next article, which is Places in News, that is Gabon. So this article came in PIB. So what's in news is that Invest in Gabon campaign is going on. So this Gabon is a country in the continent Africa. So as we all know that India is having some interest on the African countries to develop its ambitious Asia-Africa growth corridor. So this Gabon has to be noted for the prelims perspective. So now we shall see some of the facts about this Western African country of Gabon. So geographically, this Gabon is surrounded by Cameroon and a small country of Equatorial Guinea on the north, and Cameroon on the north, and east it is surrounded by Congo. So three countries bound this country of Gabon, and in the west you can see this is the Atlantic Ocean, that is the South Atlantic Ocean. And one more major fact is that the equatorial line passes through this country of Gabon. So it is having the equatorial climate, and also 80% of the country's land is having the equatorial rainforest. Apart from this, 85% of the country's landmass is having huge resource of oil and petroleum. So this serves as the major portion of GDP, that is the 45% of GDP of Gabon is dependent on this oil and petroleum reserves. Economically speaking, this Gabon is having the fourth highest GDP at purchasing power parity. Also, it stands fourth at the Human Development Index report. So this Gabon is having Libreville as its capital, and there is one national park in this near to this Libreville, that is the Onga Ongio National Park, and a cocoa beach near its the northwestern end, and Ugo River flows through this Gabon, and a low preserve is there, and Mount Ibaundji is also a major geographical location in this country of Gabon. Now the last article for the prelims is the Protecting the Indigenous People of Andaman and Nicobar Islands, and this article has been taken from the Hindu. So demographically speaking, Andaman and Nicobar is inhabited by four ancient tribal groups of Great Andamanese, Onjes, Jarawa and Sentinelese. All these four are categorized under the particularly vulnerable tribal groups of the Indian government. Apart from this, two Mongoloid tribal communities, that is the Shompens and the Nicobaris, are also present in the Nicobar Islands. According to the Indian Constitution of Article 21, Right to Life, these particularly vulnerable tribal groups must be protected properly. Sadly, there is poor implementation of various provisions to protect these tribal groups. We shall see what are the India's policies towards these tribals. The first initiative in the year 1956, wherein which a regulation is passed to protect the Andaman Nicobar Island protection of Aboriginal tribes. This regulation has been taken its genesis from the Panchsheel Agreement of Nehru government in 1955. Adding to this, the Supreme Court has also opined to follow a policy of non-intervention among these Andaman and Nicobaris tribal groups. But this regulation has been only implemented in the year of 2005 with some changes, like the term of imprisonment has been widened, and the fine was initially proposed to is only rupees 1000. So this has been amended to rupees 5000. Those who are violating the policy of non-intervention with these tribal groups. Globally, there are also some of the International Labour Organization's Indigenous and Tribal Populations Convention of 1957. This convention follows an integrationist approach towards tribal communities. This convention was signed and ratified by Indian government. Following this 1957 convention, in 1989 also, there is a convention which insists on the policy of non-intervention based on recognizing the aspirations of these peoples to exercise their own control over their own institutions. Indian government stands still over this 1989 convention and haven't signed or ratified this convention. So the way forward is to, as soon as possible, to adopt this 1989 convention, which emphasizes on the policy of non-intervention among these tribal groups. And the second one is to have a concrete efforts to create, to protect these tribal community. And the third one is to sensitize the insiders and outsiders about these community, and thereby to prevent the such mishaps that has taken place recently. So we have done with the prelims topics. Now we are going to see with the topics for mains, that are four topics. The first one is that In a Spirit of Accommodation, which speaks about the tussle between the RBI and government. And the second one is that Without Maternity Benefits, which speaks about the Pradhan Mantri Matritva Vandana Yojana and its compliance with the National Food Security Act. The third article is that The Ethical Concerns Related to the Genetic Modification. Fourth one is that What India Can Teach Us About the Startups. The first article is that In a Spirit of Accommodation. This article has been taken from the paper Hindu. This article pertains to paper 3. As we all know, the ongoing tussle between the RBI and government on the institutional autonomy is further elevating, and this should be condemned, and proper steps has to be adopted as soon as possible. The main itching point is that this section 7 of the RBI Act gives the government to issue directions to the RBI in public interest. So this section 7 is very wide and vague, wherein the government is implementing various strategies and various directions that curbs the institutional autonomy of RBI. This current spate between RBI and government is not new. There is a history of past fights between RBI and government, which started in the year of 1935 and it continued to 1949 to 57. And 1975 also in 1977. Even after independence, the institutional autonomy of RBI was questioned and a spate was going on between the RBI and government. Responding to the institutional autonomy, Nehru has suggested that monetary policies must necessarily depend upon the larger policies of the government. So there is a nexus between the monetary policies and the policies of the government related to the social dimensions. It is the responsibility of RBI to advise the government for framing larger policies, which is influenced by the monetary policies. In practice, monetary policy measures were never announced without the concurrence of the finance minister. So, though the monetary policy comes under the domain of RBI, it never had been announced without the concurrence of the finance minister. So, here the autonomy is getting blurred. The second reason, as stated by the author, that questions the RBI's autonomy is the relationship between the RBI and the RBI's Central Board of Directors. For this, for prelims, we have to note what is the composition of this Central Board of Directors. It comprises the RBI Governor, 4 Deputy Governors. Apart from this, 16 Directors are also within this Central Board of Directors. You have to note these 16 Directors are nominated by the government, in which 2 are from the Ministry of Finance and 10 people from various fields like academia and researchers. And these 4 regional members have been appointed by RBI only. Now we shall see what is the issue between the RBI board and RBI. You have to note that the Clause 2 of Section 7 states that the affairs and business of the bank shall be entrusted to the Central Board of Directors, which may exercise all powers and do all acts with respect to the banks. So here all the powers has been conferred to the central board of directors, that is comprising of the RBI and the government people, according to this clause 2. But contradicting to this clause 2 of section 7, there is clause 3 of the same section, wherein which the governor has been given the power of general superintendence and direction of the affairs related to the business of the bank. So these two clauses of the same section is opposing each other. So this forms a bone of contention between the RBI and government, which has to be taken at times of conflicting interests. So this is the area of concern for the RBI and the RBI board comprising the government officials. And one more thing is that the board is empowered to discuss and even pass resolution regarding the business of the banks and other monetary policy decisions. So in order to stop this tug of war between RBI and government, it is essential to clarify whether the board's decisions are binding or not, and their interests are complying with the RBI's role of monetary decisions. As of now, the board by and large has played only an advisory role. So the way forward to stop this tussle is that the governor, who is empowered to act and superintend the business of the banks, he has to act on his own and also must listen to what the members feel, and the sense of the board must be fully reflected in his actions. So it is only in the hands of the governor to act accordingly with the interests of the board members. The crux of the problem is that the RBI, the board and the government must understand the limits to which they can push. Though there are overlapping powers between these three institutions, there is a need to have a spirit of accommodation between these three institutions. Only then the spate between the RBI and the government can be solved as soon as possible. Following the previous article, there is one more thing which is related to that: the deposition of the RBI before the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Finance. So the takeaways from the report submitted by the RBI is that the profitability of the banks will continue to remain under great stress because of two reasons, that is the evergreening of NPAs, that is the bad loans, evergreening of NPAs and taking more haircuts on the non-performing assets through the insolvency process. In addition to this, the banks will also have to be wary of their small loans portfolio, which speaks about the loans that has been conferred to the MSMEs through the Pradhan Mantri Mudra Yojana scheme. Also, the center is planning to push to set up a board committee to assist the RBI in discharge of its work. So these areas should be properly addressed as soon as possible to restore the health of the Indian economy. The second article now we are going to see is related to without maternity benefits. And this article has been taken from the Hindu. Here the author states about the National Food Security Act of 2013, which enables every pregnant woman entitled with the maternity benefits of rupees 6,000 of cash incentive through 3 installments if she is not a government employee. Taking a cue from this National Food Security Act, the Pradhan Mantri Matritva Vandana Yojana scheme of the Indian government also provides cash incentives for the improved health and nutrition to pregnant and lactating mothers. This Pradhan Mantri Matritva Vandana Yojana has failed to comply with the National Food Security Act of 2013 in respect to that the benefits have been reduced from rupees 6,000 to rupees 5,000 per child in case of this PMMVY. So they are now restricted to the first living child only, which means that the subsequently born child are not entitled to the benefits of this scheme. They are also further restricted to only the women of above the age of 18 years. Also, it excludes more than half of all pregnancies because of the first order births that accounts only for about 43% in India. One of the main limitations of this scheme is that the cumbersome and exclusionary application process. As I have already said that the incentive of rupees 5000 will be issued through three installments. In these three installments, the application to have to be filled separately by the beneficiary. So this is an ill effect of this scheme. Another limitation is that the compulsory linking of the bank account with Aadhaar will only enable the beneficiary to get the direct benefit transfer of this cash incentive through the scheme of Matritva Vandana Yojana. Apart from this, this scheme provides only little assistance to women who lose their baby. The way forward to resolve the ill effects of this scheme is to have a provision for maternity entitlements for women who are not employed in the formal sector. As the informal sector comprises of more women laborers, they are not benefited under this ambitious scheme. So this has to be widened and inclusive of those people also. Apart from this, there is need for better implementation as well as the better compliance of the scheme with respect to the National Food Security Act. And this maternity benefit should be conferred for all pregnancies and not just the first living child. And this should be raised to rupees 6000 as proposed by the National Food Security Act per child at least. The next article is the genetic modification goes beyond ethics. So this article has been taken from the paper Mint and it pertains to the GS paper 3. So what's in news is that the world's first genetically edited baby has been designed by the Chinese doctor without any legal provisions. This genetically edited baby has been developed through a technique called CRISPR-Cas9, which means that clustered, regularly interspaced, short palindromic repeats, which is referred as the gene editing tool. So, we shall see how this technique works for gene editing. So now we shall see how this technique is going to work for gene editing. So this is a cell within which a nucleus is there. Inside the nucleus, the chromosomes are present, wherein which a defective gene is present. So this defective gene has to be replaced with the healthy gene through the process of gene editing method. Here, a DNA cutting enzyme called Cas9 has to be used to cut the defective gene from the healthy DNA strand and replaced with the healthy DNA strand. So this CRISPR-Cas9 is nothing but a find and replace function. If this genetically engineered baby is born with some unpredicted results, the scientific community is not under a position to treat it. So this may pass down to the other future generations also. So the defect is going to continue for further coming generations. The other ethical concern is that these genetically created babies are born without any consent from these unborn babies. Apart from this, another sociological concern is that if the genetically engineered baby technique are legalized, then it may lead to the proliferation of perfectly designed babies that leads to the homogenization of society. And this may cause inequality among the society, wherein which only the rich people can access the service of designing their own babies without any concern from the unborn baby. The last article we are going to see is that what can India teach us about the startups. So this article has been taken from the paper Mint. In this article, the author says that there is an empirical evidence that there is a strong link between the startups and job growth in India. In the Indian scenario, the rate of new startups in India is too low besides the governmental initiatives of skill development and Startup India program. This is because of the huge heterogeneity, that is, the spatial distribution of the startups is very discrete in India. So these two scenarios forms a barrier to harness the potential from the demographic dividends. The factors contributing to this startup climate is that the local education levels, which is not penetrating to the rural areas from where the youth can be employed into these startups. So the human capital and the technology are not productively utilized. Also, the quality of the physical infrastructure in the manufacturing sector is also not up to the mark to support these startups. Now we shall see the employment growth in the manufacturing sector. Though globalization has promoted the rise of the small and medium scale enterprises, there is some of the ill effects present in the Indian scenario, where the startups are only in the tradable sector and not in the non-tradable sector. So this shows an impact on the employment growth. Apart from this, India's gender balance in entrepreneurship is also affected due to varied reasons like the inadequate infrastructure. Basically, the transport infrastructure is not provided. Thereby, it lead to the safety concerns, especially for the women entrepreneurs to enter into the Startup India program. The greater constraints for this is that the non-availability of basic amenities like water and electricity to these poor entrepreneurs. This becomes a burden of women in the way that they are employed as a household workers and not wanting to enter into the entrepreneurship program. So these ill effects should be addressed in order to increase the startups in India and thereby harness the potential of the demographic dividends. Thank you.